We'll call the February 6th meeting of the Verona Plan Commission to order. We'll begin with the roll call. Mr. Sayre, if you would, please.
Commissioner Manley.
Here.
Alderperson Linder.
Here.
Mayor Holcomer.
Here.
Commissioner Horsfall.
Here.
Commissioner Lytle.
Here.
Commissioner Heinzen.
Here.
And Commissioner Turk is absent and excused.
We have a quorum, so we will proceed with the agenda. First on the agenda is approval of minutes from the January 3rd meeting of the Plan Commission, and those minutes were included with your packet. What's your pleasure? We have a motion by Mr. Horsfall. Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Mr. Manley. Were there any additions or corrections to the minutes? Seeing none, all those in favor of approval of the minutes signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, no. Motion carried. We are now on agenda item number 4, which is a public hearing for a conditional use permit for a proposed indoor commercial entertainment land use known as Four Sisters Restaurant, to be located at 958 Liberty Drive. I would accept the motion to open the public hearing.
So moved.
We have a motion by Mr. Linder. Is there a second?
Aye.
Second by Mr. Manley. All those in favor of opening the public hearing signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Motion carried. We are in the public hearing stage. Mr. Sayre, if you would provide the background, please.
Thank you. This is a conditional use permit for an indoor commercial entertainment land use. Indoor commercial entertainment land uses include restaurants. The zoning ordinance does require a public hearing be held before the Plan Commission, and the Plan Commission makes a recommendation to the Common Council.
Thank you, Mr. Sayre. With that, is there anyone in the audience that wishes to speak on this agenda item? Again, we are on the public hearing for agenda item 4A. Is there anyone that wishes to speak on this agenda item? Anyone wishing to speak? Seeing none, I would accept the motion to close the public hearing.
So moved.
We have a motion by Mr. Lytle. Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Mr. Horsfall. All those in favor of closing the public hearing signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, no. Motion carried. Mr. Sayre, if you would, please.
Thank you. The request would be located at the northwest corner of Liberty Drive and County Highway M in Liberty Business Park. The property in question is highlighted on the screen before you. This is the same building that currently has the Verona Woods that recently opened in the western part of the building. The Four Sisters Restaurant would occupy approximately 4,000 square feet of space. They would have 119 indoor seats and approximately 71 outdoor seats. Once again, this is just an overview of the entire Liberty Park. Once again, the Four Sisters would be located in this building at the northwest corner. Staff did review the parking on the site. The project does require between 40 and 64 parking spaces. The range is based upon the fact that it does have both indoor and outdoor seating. The overall site currently has 146 parking spaces. The city did approve a parking expansion here last fall that did expand the parking on the west side of the building. Overall, looking at the uses in the building, which includes the Verona Woods, the Four Sisters Restaurant, and also the retail and office uses, the site requires between 112 and 168 parking spaces. Currently, the site has 146 and does conform to the parking requirements. As I said previously, there is an outdoor patio that is planned on the east side of the site. Staff has no concerns in this patio, but does recommend that we include the standard conditions of approval that we include on all patios. Staff did go through the general and specific findings of facts, and we do find that it does meet the requirements. So with that, staff recommends the Plan Commission recommend to the Common Council approval of the conditional use permit to allow an indoor commercial entertainment land use known as Four Sisters Restaurant to be located at 958 Liberty Drive with the following conditions. One, the use of the outdoor seating area is permitted to operate between 7 a.m. and 10 p.m. 7 days a week. Two, the outdoor patio fencing shall be a minimum of 48 inches tall. Three, the outdoor patio fencing material shall be approved by the Director of Planning and Development. Four, the exit for the patio shall be labeled as an exit only. And five, the fence and gate for the outdoor patio shall comply with the requirements from the police department and the building inspector. With that, I'd be happy to answer any questions you have.
Thank you, Mr. Sayre. Questions, comments from Planning Commission members? Questions, comments, potential motions? Mr. Manley, please.
I'll make a motion to recommend that the Common Council approve the proposed conditional use permits with the contingencies that are in the staff recommendation.
Okay, we have a motion by Mr. Manley. Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Mr. Lytle. We are now open for questions or comments on the motion. Questions or comments? Seeing none, all those in favor of the motion to recommend approval of the conditional use permit for proposed indoor commercial entertainment land use known as Four Sisters Restaurant to be located at 958 Liberty Drive, signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, no. That motion carries. We are now on agenda item 5, which is a public hearing and a conditional use permit for proposed indoor commercial entertainment land use known as Nela Restaurant to be located at 957 Liberty Drive. I would accept the motion to open the public hearing. We have a motion by Mr. Linder. Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Mr. Horsfall. All those in favor of opening the public hearing signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, no. Motion carried. Mr. Sayre, if you would, please.
Thank you. Once again, this is an indoor commercial entertainment land use, which includes restaurants. This does require a public hearing before the Plan Commission, and this will be a recommendation to the Common Council.
Thank you, Mr. Sayre. Is there anyone from the public that wishes to speak on this agenda item? Is there anyone from the public that wishes to speak? I will give three times. Anyone that wishes to speak on this agenda item? Seeing none, I would accept the motion to close the public hearing. We have a motion by Mr. Horsfall. Is there a second? Seconded by Mr. Linder. All those in favor of closing the public hearing signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, no. Motion carried. Mr. Sayre, please.
Thank you. As the mayor stated previously, this is a request for Nalia Restaurant to be located at 957 Liberty Drive. This is the property located at the northeast corner of Liberty Drive and County Highway M. The same building currently has Sugar River Pizza on the western end of this building. Nalia would occupy the eastern side of this project. The request is for the restaurant would have 72 indoor seats and 48 outdoor seats. Once again, just an overview of the project. We have the project located here. Fisher King Winery is located to the north, and ultimately, and we also have the hotel that is currently under construction at the northwest corner of Fortune and Liberty Drive. Staff reviewed the project. The first thing we looked at was the parking that's currently on the site. The site has 92 parking spaces that have been provided. The overall project and development, looking at the uses of Sugar River Pizza, Nalia, and the retail office uses, the project does require 113 to 153 parking spaces. So the site is slightly short on the parking requirements. In order to kind of keep this project moving forward, staff does recommend that if there is an approval tonight to place conditions on that approval. Those conditions would include a condition that the applicant shall receive site plan approval for additional parking prior to the issuance of building permits. And also we'd recommend that there be the parking shall be constructed before occupancy would be granted on the site as well too. There may be some options that the applicant can take a look at with existing drive aisles to expand the parking, but we would need additional parking spaces added to at least fall within that range of 113 to 153 spaces. The developer also contacted me last week and suggested the restaurant could only be open for potentially breakfast and lunch, so that could also potentially be an option as of looking at this as well. So we may need to build some flexibility, I guess, into the condition of approval of how we want to handle this from a Plan Commission standpoint if you choose to make a recommendation tonight. There is outdoor seating planned for this. Similar to the last project, it'll be located on the east side of the building, and it will contain approximately 48 seats. We did go through the general and specific findings of facts and finds that it does meet those requirements. So staff recommends the Plan Commission recommend the Common Council approval of the conditional use permit to allow an indoor commercial entertainment land use known as Nalia Restaurant to be located at 957 Liberty Drive with the following conditions. One, the use of the outdoor seating area is permitted to operate between 7 a.m. and 10 p.m. 7 days a week. Two, outdoor patio fencing shall be a minimum of 48 inches tall. Three, the outdoor patio fencing material shall be approved by the Director of Planning and Development. Four, the exit for the patio shall be labeled as exit only. Five, the fence and gate for the outdoor patio shall comply with the requirements from the police department and building inspector. Six, prior to the issuance of building permits, the applicant shall submit a site plan for approval that meets the minimum parking requirements of the zoning ordinance. And seven, occupancy for Nalia Restaurant shall not be granted until the applicant constructs parking that meets the minimum parking requirements of the zoning ordinance. And with that, I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Thank you, Mr. Sayre. Again, this will be a recommendation to the Common Council. Questions, comments, potential motions? Mr. Manley, please.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I have a question about the parking, and you said that additional parking would be needed, and I wonder if you have an opinion on how many parking spaces would be needed. And so that's my first question. And my second question is kind of a follow-up to your comment about only being open for breakfast and lunch, which it seems like it's configured for something other beyond that because there's a bar. But was the thinking that that would address the parking situation, or was there some other reason why the applicant talked about possibly being only open for breakfast and lunch?
Mr. Sayre, please.
Yeah, regarding a specific number for parking, I think you need at least about 21 to get within that minimum range. I think adding about 40 would probably go a long ways. And the reason that I have the parking concern is obviously Sugar River Pizza is doing quite well. You have Fisher King, who recently opened and has a large event space as well, too. You know, we have additional projects planned that have been talked about to the east of the site as well, too. If those projects, and more importantly, the parking, would have gone forward, this wouldn't have been an issue. The intent out here all along has been kind of to share the parking among all the users, and I think we've kind of hit that crunch where I think there's some concerns potentially of the parking now spilling into the street. So my feeling is we'd at least need 21 spaces, but if we got to about 40 being added, it would benefit this overall area in general. Regarding the restricting the operations to breakfast and lunch, that's something the developer mentioned to me last week. I tend to kind of agree with, I wonder how that impacts their operations. I think the intent behind that was, if it was limited just breakfast and lunch, you have time of day restrictions where you typically have Sugar River Pizza, who's busy at night. This would basically keep the condition as it is today. But I think probably the better option would be just to add additional parking, and then we don't have to worry about what time of business is closing and creating a potential issue out there. So I can go either way. If the Plan Commission wanted to look at restricting, I guess, the hours of the operation, but I think long-term the best probably option here is just to have the developer add a little more parking.
Jerry, if you would.
I'm Jerry Berkwin. I'm with the Dimension 4 Architects, and we're the architects working on the restaurant space. So I think on the parking, if you look, we've got that drive aisle coming down along the east side of like Fisher King Winery, and we're only parking on the one side. And I can use that drive aisle and actually kind of just add stalls coming down that side, and I can probably pick up like another 25 stalls right away, which is kind of minimal because I've already got the drive, so I'm just kind of picking up the parking at the same time. So I think we're looking at that, and we're kind of working with that. We've got Adam mentioned, we've got a couple other buildings kind of coming in that area at the same time, which I think will probably take care of the overall long-term parking. But I think for a short-term, our preference is probably to handle it that way, to pick up those additional stalls, at least right now, to handle that. The hours of operation, I probably would not want to restrict that right now, because I think the operators in there right now is probably operating a little different model than what I think the developer is kind of looking at also. So he will be open in evens right now on the patio, so I don't think we really want to limit the hours. But I think we can pick up the parking stalls with a minimal impact out there.
Okay. Other questions for Jerry as long as he's at the podium? Not seeing any, but I know you'll be available if there are more. Additional comments or questions, potential motions? Mr. Manley?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. And question for Adam. In terms of the building that's there right now, we've got Sugar River Pizza in there. This is proposed. Would there be any vacant space left in this building, or would this fill the building out?
I believe this would fill the first floor out. I'm not sure if there's vacancies on the second floor, but typically the second floor in both of these buildings has been office professional space. So in this building, you have Sugar River Pizza. I believe you have a salon of some type, and then you'd have this restaurant as well. But then there would be potentially additional build-out on the second floor. But it's what you're finding down there is financial people, potentially an insurance agent or a real estate agent. You're not finding heavy traffic users on that second floor.
So not the type of uses that you would expect to further stress the parking.
No, restaurants are what stresses the parking, or if there was like a fitness studio in there, that would stress the parking. But I don't see that happening, and if it did, and once again, it'd be a conditional use permit, and it would come back here.
Okay, thank you.
Further questions, comments? Mr. Lytle, please.
Thank you. So the proposal of eliminating or reconfiguring the drive aisle is still sort of a stopgap measure as additional parking is added in the overall area there? I don't know, Adam, or if you answer, if I want to get clarification from the...
Yeah, I would say it's more of a stopgap. I mean, I think it solves the problem to kind of keep this moving forward. And I think, you know, assuming there's projects coming here to the east in the near future, that's the solution to this. This would kind of be the stopgap to at least kind of fill that initially and kind of deal with it. The challenge here is when we calculate the parking on these, we're looking at both the indoor and the outdoor. So if you look just at the indoor, if you add those 25 spaces, yeah, it meets it easily. But once you start looking at that outdoor patio capacity, which is good for 4 or 5 months out of the year, that's when it kind of tips the scale. So, I mean, I think what Jerry is suggesting is reasonable. We talked about it a week ago, and I thought that was reasonable, too. So I'm fine with that if we can get to about 20, 25 spaces there.
Yeah, I mean, I think I've certainly seen some creative parking happening already, at least towards the west end of that building with Sugar River. I'm sure people maybe aren't looking all the way around currently, but I could see that the parking would be or continue to be an issue with more tenants moving in. A couple follow-up questions, if I may. So the hours of operation proposed are till 2, which I think sort of adds to the mix of options available to people staying at the hotel or frequenting that area. What are the, for the other businesses that are already in operation, are there any in that park, Wisconsin Brewing or the Woods that just opened? Do we have similar hours of operation for other restaurants in that area?
Mr. Sarah, please.
I don't know off the top of my head. Wisconsin Brewing Company, I believe, stops in the summer at about midnight at the latest on the weekends.
Okay.
11, 10 o'clock during the week. The Woods, I think probably, I'm just going off my top of my head, I think it's 11, 12. And Fisher King closes at 9.
Okay.
And Sugar River Pizza is probably, once again, 10, 11, 12.
I know this discussion came up when they were adding the patio seating for Hop House, where the hours of operation for the interior of the restaurant extended further or longer than for the outdoor patio area. Have you been made aware of any issues with enforcing that? People going out to grab a smoke and being loud past restaurant hours, that kind of thing that have occurred at Hop House?
At Hop House? No, I'm not aware of any.
Okay.
No. One thing I should note as well is the hotel will also have a bar type, small little restaurant bar as well, too. I'm not sure what the hours of that's going to be, but there will also be an additional bar in the restaurant, too, or oh. Bar in the hotel.
Okay. Thank you.
Further questions or comments? Mr. Horsfall, please.
Yeah, question for Adam. So is the additional parking going to be in lot 28? So that's the development to the east. Is that what we were talking about?
Correct. That means we've looked at a couple initial reviews for that property. We've looked at at one point a two-story type daycare use on that site. I think the last one we looked at was a single-story type commercial retail type use there. But yeah, the intent has always been that all the parking in this whole area would be kind of shared amongst the users.
So but because it's two different lots, then they have to get like an agreement between the lots? Is that how that works?
It's owned by the same developer. So the developer who is developing this actually has maintained ownership of all the lots in here.
Oh,
so they wouldn't need any. He would just have to build it.
Further questions, comments, potential motions? Mr. Manley?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. If I were to make a motion to recommend that the Common Council approve the conditional use permit with the conditions outlined in the staff report. Would the additional parking spaces that we just talked about this evening satisfy that seventh condition that occupancy shall not be granted until the applicant constructs parking that meets the minimum parking requirements of the zoning ordinance?
Mr. Sarah?
No, it would not. They'd have to actually build that additional parking before they could open for business. But it would potentially get closer to satisfying number six. So Mr. Berkman would have to submit a site plan showing that it's, you know, we're adding those X amount of spaces. That would satisfy number six so we can get the building permit issued. And then while they're building out that space, which will probably take 3 months, 4 months, give or take, they could construct that parking lot because the asphalt plants will open in the spring. So they have time to deal with both of those easily.
I guess the question I was asking, though, is that with that number of additional spaces, that 20-ish, does that get them to compliance with number seven?
It would get in that minimum range. There's a range in the report. It would put them in that range.
Okay. Okay, great. Then I'll make a motion to recommend that the Common Council approve the conditional use permit with the seven conditions outlined in the staff report.
We have a motion by Mr. Manley. Is there a second? Seconded by Mr. Linder. Questions or comments on the motion? Mr. Horsfall?
Just a quick question. Parking, what is the level of, if it's a gravel, is that considered parking? Or is it, does it have to be, is there some definition in the ordinance that says parking is actually asphalt?
The definition is in the ordinance says it must be to the level of a satisfaction of the Director of Public Works.
Okay.
So it is slightly ambiguous. The requirement that we've used in the past that you have to have the first lift of asphalt on it, that's the typical requirement that needs to be in place. So in this case, once again, they'd have to have at least one lift of asphalt on it unless the director approves something differently.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions or comments on the motion? Seeing none, the motion before you is to recommend the approval of the conditional use permit with the contingencies outlined in the staff report. Seeing no further questions or comments, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, no. And that motion carries. We are now on agenda item number six, which is a public hearing on a general development plan for a planned unit development known as Sugar Creek Commons, located at 501 West Verona Avenue, 503 West Verona Avenue, 507 West Verona Avenue, 513 West Verona Avenue, and 100 Legion Street, and 501 through 522 Top Avenue, that would allow for the construction of a 284 apartment units, 18,500 square feet of retail space, and a 63,000 square foot office slash retail building. Do I have a motion to open the public hearing? We have a motion by Mr. Linder. Is there a second?
Second.
Seconded by Mr. Manley. All those in favor of opening the public hearing signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, no. Motion carried. Mr. Sayre, if you would, please.
Thank you. The request tonight is for a general development plan, GDP approval. This is step three of four in the plan development process. The plan development process's first step is a pre-applications conference with staff. The second step is a concept plan review that goes before the Plan Commission and Common Council. That concept plan review has no action to it, but it is a chance for the Plan Commission and Council to provide feedback to the applicant. After that comes step three, which is the general development plan. That is where there is a public hearing before the Plan Commission. The Plan Commission makes a recommendation to the Common Council. Step three of the project is where the entitlements, the zoning entitlements, are granted the project. The last step, which would come after this if it is approved, would be the precise implementation plan, the PIP. That's where specific building designs and details are submitted to the Plan Commission and Common Council for approval. And in that case, you'd have then, if those buildings are approved, the applicant then could then apply for building permits, and then you'd see the buildings coming out of the ground. So for tonight, we're at step three, which is a public hearing before the Plan Commission. And the Plan Commission then will make a recommendation on this matter to the Common Council.
Thank you, Mr. Sayre. With that, we are in the public hearing stage. Is there anyone from the public that wishes to speak on this agenda item? Is there anyone from the public that wishes to speak? Your third and final opportunity on this one. Anyone desiring to speak on this agenda item? Seeing none, I would accept the motion to close the public hearing.
So moved.
We have a motion by Mr. Linder. Is there a second?
Second.
Seconded by Mr. What was that? Mr. Steve, Mr. Heinzen. All those in favor of closing the public hearing, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Motion carried. Mr. Sayre, please.
Thank you. This project is located along West Vronin Avenue. It's bounded by Legion Street on the east. The southern end of just south of Top Avenue on the south. Top Avenue is the cul-de-sac street that's located here. And then also on the west side here of the old truck stop gas station. That's along Vronin Avenue. The Plan Commission did provide an initial or concept review of this project at the December 2016 Plan Commission meeting. The Plan Commission's comments included a desire to see the property redeveloped and the questions about traffic impact from this project on Vronin Avenue. The project also did go to the Common Council in December for a concept review. The Council has a desire to see this property redeveloped, a desire to see the creation of workforce housing, and questions and concerns about the project's density. The applicant has submitted revised plans, which are before you tonight. One change that I just wanted to point out immediately is that in the initial concept, there was a hotel banquet facility that was planned along the western edge of this site. The applicant still intends to go forward with that portion of the project, but as part of the GDP process, is the property owners have to sign off on this. So majority of these parcels, or actually all the parcels here in yellow, are under contract. The developer is pursuing purchasing the parcel to the west there, which they're intending still to buy that. But that owner at this time expressed a desire not to grant permission basically to go forward with the project or get the entitlements granted on the property until the developer actually buys the property. So just the concern potentially of if the project weren't to go forward, that particular owner didn't want to have his property under contract and locked up and prevented from being purchased by someone else. So just wanted to point out the intent of the developer is still to build that portion of it, but for that reason they had to basically take that out of the submittal tonight. So before you tonight is three buildings or three components of the project. Once again, we have a mixed-use building along Vronin Avenue that will have approximately 18,500 square feet of commercial space, and we'll have apartments above on the second and third levels. There's the office retail component at the corner of Legion Street and Vronin Avenue. That building will be approximately 63,000 square feet and three stories in height. And then we have the multifamily building on the south side of the site. That building will range in between the heights of three to four stories. The overall number of units in this project that has been planned is 284 units. The hotel is still obviously shown in the site plan of how it would be configured. The hotel project could be included later into this plan development, or it could be done under conventional zoning. The Holiday Inn Express, for example, that was done under conventional zoning. So there's still some options of how that could be handled quite easily, but for the time being, it is not included in this project. The applicant is requesting bulk exemptions from the project. The buildings themselves will have a strong street presence along both Vronin Avenue and Legion Street. The exemptions from the front setback are quite small. I believe these buildings are currently set back approximately 14 feet from Vronin Avenue and Legion. The setback of that overlay, the downtown overlay district, is 15 feet, so the exemptions for the setbacks are quite small for the front. One important thing to note here is staff is recommending a condition of approval on this for the development of a TIA, a traffic impact analysis. Depending on the results of that TIA, there could be some changes to the site plan to accommodate potential turn lanes and traffic movements. So there is that the one caveat that we do want to look at traffic from this project in the area, and just to make sure that we're placing buildings appropriately and not setting ourselves up for future issues of having buildings where we want roadway. So that is a recommended condition that if the project goes forward, staff would recommend be included in here. The parking itself, the project would have a total of 614 parking spaces. 221 of those spaces would be on the surface and 393 would be underground. Just for comparison's sake, the mixed-use building here would have approximately 50 parking stalls. Building C, which is the office retail building, would have approximately 91 parking stalls. And then the multifamily building on the south side would have 252 underground parking stalls. The applicant does provide a kind of breakout of the on page 20 of their submittal, which talks about the time of day demands that will be occurring on the site. So typically the underground would be reserved for the tenants of those buildings. The site does provide one underground space per unit for the multifamily in each of the buildings. But the underground would be utilized typically by the people parking there and living there. During the day, the surface would be used heavily by obviously the retail and the office users in there. At night, when people would leave, once again, you'd have the residential potentially for the overflow type parking as well, too. One thing to note is that a parking analysis was not completed at this time for the hotel or the banquet. And once again, if that project goes forward, there will be some overflow and cross parking access easements across this site and that site as well, too, when that property is in use. Access to the site, the applicant is proposing two access points right now from West Rhone Avenue. You'd have the main access point here and then also a potential shared access point with the hotel, and then there'd be one access point from Legion Street. I think at this time staff doesn't have any concerns with those. The site currently has many access points, so we'll have a reduction in the number of access points that are on the property, but we'll defer specific comments once that TIA is actually completed. There is a drive-through that is planned as part of the project as well, too, in this location. And there's also a drop-off location for the office retail component as well. Details of that, those kind of areas, once again, will be reviewed as part of the PIP. Stormwater, drainage and landscaping, once again, those are reviewed at the PIP submittal. Those are details that we will work out with the applicant as the project goes forward. The phasing of the project, initially the applicant had identified a phasing of, this is looking to the south, the apartment building, that'd be the first phase of the project. The second phase would be the office at the corner of Legion and Frone Avenue. And the third phase would potentially be the mixed-use building along West Frone Avenue as well. Potentially also you could have the hotel, be one of the first projects that comes out of the ground as well too. Design, the building would have a strong presence along West Rhone Avenue. The applicant has provided this conceptual sketch in the packet. This is the building that you're looking towards the southeast. So you have the three-story office building at the corner, and then you'd have the mixed-use building in this location here. The applicant is proposing high-quality materials, including brick, cast stone, metal, and cement board siding. At this time, staff doesn't have any concerns with the proposed design. We would anticipate that the type of materials and the type of design would carry throughout the site, but as it's designed right now, it would provide that strong commercial retail presence along Verona Avenue and contain high quality materials. Part of the project, the applicant is requesting exemptions. Exemptions are being requested, including the front yard setback exemption and also paved surface setback exemptions. The applicant's also requesting a density exemption. The overall density for the project is currently at 40.77 dwelling units per acre. That's a density based upon this site just for the PUD and not the hotel property. The applicant is also requesting parking reductions as part of the project for the minimum parking requirements. And finally, the applicant is requesting a height exemption. The tallest building, which is the multifamily building, the four-story multifamily building, is 44 feet tall. The ordinance allows for a maximum height of 35 feet. In general, staff is supportive of the exemptions. One interesting thing that I will point out is that part of the property is currently zoned urban commercial. That district allows for densities up to 50 dwelling units per acre if it's developed as a mixed-use project. I'm just letting the Plan Commission be aware that the site right now, if it was developed under conventional zoning under the urban commercial district, they would potentially have up to 50 DUs per acre. I actually wasn't aware of that myself until I closely read into that part of the ordinance. So as you're aware, the city does have a residential phasing policy that's in place. There are exemptions to that policy. One of those exemptions is redevelopment and downtown development and also mixed-use development. This project does have the potential to be exempted from that policy. A couple comments from staff. Staff continues to support the redevelopment of this site. There is contamination on the property, so it is a challenging property to redevelop because of the contamination up from the gas station that used to be there. So it is challenging. The developer is proposing to use a high quality development that will have a strong commercial presence along Verona Avenue and will also provide a smooth transition from the commercial land uses in the development to the residential land uses. So with that, staff recommends the Plan Commission recommend to the Common Council approval of the GDP for the Sugar Creek Commons with the following conditions. One, prior to the submittal of a PIP, a TIA shall be completed and approved by the city staff. And two, the GDP shall become effective upon Forward Development Group acquiring the properties identified within the GDP submittal. With that, I'd be happy to answer your questions. The developers here tonight also, and they'd be happy to answer your questions too.
Mr. Heinzen, did you have a question? Oh, you don't? Okay. Thank you. Questions or comments for Adam or potential motions? Mr. Horsfall?
Yeah, so Adam, I guess the question is, if the density exemption of 12 dwellings per acre, if the density intensity exemption that they're asking for of 12 dwellings per acre, if they can have 50 dwellings per acre, why is it an exemption then?
Mr. Sarah, please.
So as part of this, you know, it's always how do you zone the property, how do you typically look at it? So you have the multifamily component in the back, which, you know, those properties along Top Avenue are currently zoned urban residential. So that is within that 12 DUs per acre. The properties along Verona Avenue are zoned urban commercial. So you kind of have a split zoning and split area. I think in generally, as we look at multifamily, we typically use that 12 as the kind of overall, regardless of the project or not. And I think that's, in my opinion, it's probably the easiest way to keep looking at that from the standpoint of typically of any multifamily project, you have 12 DUs per acre. And I think to be consistent, just kind of keeping that number versus the 50. The 50 I just threw out as a, one, I was surprised to see it in there. And second, if this project wasn't happening and someone came for just the front half that was owned urban commercial, there would be some potential to kind of maybe not have an exemption to that at all.
Okay. Go ahead, Mr.
So my comments on this are, I think it's a nice project. And back in December, again, I was concerned about the density. So that's, at this density, I'm not gonna feel comfortable voting for it or moving forward. And as we found out, when we get to this point in the process, once it gets approved at this point, then pretty much it's all go gangbusters and it's going to get approved. So this is really the opportunity to make some comments about the density or the heights of the buildings, and otherwise it's just going to go through and nothing we can do about it. So I'm at this point, I'm not going to vote on for this on the current design. Thanks.
Thank you. Other comments, questions, feedback? Mr. Lytle, please.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I was not able to attend the December meeting when this plan was originally presented. I have to say it's probably one of the most appealing concepts I've seen in the city in a long time. I think we've seen multiple attempts to redevelop a couple of these properties, and they've come up short many times. And this looks to be a full package and an attempt to create a great multi-use project in an area where I think the city could really benefit. I do share similar concerns, I think, that were brought up in December around approving 284 additional apartments. I think I'm inclined to err on the lenient side when it comes to that. However, I see a scenario that, Adam, maybe you can help me process through this, where the exemption we're claiming is for a multi-use project. The phasing proposed is for apartments first and the mixed use later. In the event that they were able to proceed with the apartments, that portion of the GDP, of the PUD, and then struggle to find tenants and financing for the other portions of the project, would we in effect be approving 284 apartment units that could, at in some scenario, be standalone and not part of a mixed-use development?
Mr. Sarah, please.
Correct. That could always happen. I guess yes. The short answer is yes. So, I believe this building back here has approximately 240 units. 204. I'm sorry. It has 204 units. Correct. Ultimately, if there were a recession or there were some type of issue and the project back here were to go forward first and the rest could be halted for whatever reason, yes, that's always a possibility. The reality is, too, that you still have these pieces along Verona Avenue. The site itself with the contamination is there. Most likely the site as a whole, especially kind of this area and through here, would be excavated all at once and cleaned at the same time. So typically when this is going to happen, you're going to see a very large hole in this area to kind of clean it out and hopefully have some type of redevelopment come in the future. But you do have that potential risk unless there's some type of phasing plan built into it.
Go ahead, Mr. Lytle.
So I would not question the forthrightness of you all coming to us with this plan, but if I were another apartment developer who maybe wouldn't assume the best of their competition, I could see them implying that the city was a bit naive in approving 204 units with no guarantee that there is a mixed-use component following. I don't make any attempt to say that people have plans like that, but we know that with many of these projects, later phases take a lot longer, get revised multiple times. Certainly, those of us that have been through the various iterations of the West End have seen that. All that being said, I think some apartments and a significant number of apartments seem reasonable here, but it seems to me, given some of the other exemptions, they're seeking a three-story, something around 150 units is a much more reasonable number to approve than 200 with another 80 coming at the street side at the north end of the project in later phases. That's the approach I'd prefer to take.
Thank you. Other feedback? Comments? Mr. Linder, please.
Thank you, Mayor. Just a important clarification, Mr. Lytle. Do you mean 150 in just a backside as opposed to 204?
Yeah, 3/4 of the 204.
Okay, thank you.
Go ahead.
First question, Mr. Sayer, you talked about the setback from Verona Road or Verona Avenue. Right now, some of the drawings we got, are they a little bit closer than they potentially would be?
The submittal indicates 14 feet. That's the setback that's been indicated in the submittal. So if there was a TIA, when the TIA is done, if there is potential, say, right-hand turn lane, especially on the Legion Street here, there may need to be adjustments made upon that.
Nothing too major from what it is proposed then? Just a few feet here and there, or something like 10 feet or more?
No, I believe the buildings are, I think, 14 and 13 off of Verona Avenue, okay. Just off the top of my head. So the setback requirement is 15, so you're talking 2 feet.
Okay. Reason I was asking is, I like the idea of being a little bit farther back so it doesn't hover over Verona Avenue as much as seen some other projects. Next question I have is about the drive-through. So it's going to go, I guess maybe this question for Mr. Montpass. What do you think of that drive-through so close to the entrance to the project on Verona Avenue?
Mr. Montpass?
I think there's going to be a concern about stacking and queuing up for that drive-through that close to that entrance. I would be concerned that people trying to enter the overall complex and being stopped by traffic into that drive-through would be something they'd have to look at, especially in the TIA.
I would assume the traffic would be going north, and that'd be the exit, though, wouldn't it?
I do not know that. I was under the assumption they would turn in and then exit and loop back around.
I mean, most of the time it's on the driver's side. And
I agree. That would even be a harder issue because now you've got people queued up to turn out,
right,
and coming in, and you would end up with a backup in the drive-through as well.
Okay. Anybody from development here want to speak to that drive-through at all?
Justin Frame with JSD Professional Services. The drive-through lane is set up such that it would exit to the north, as noted. It has substantial queuing and multiple lanes to the south of the drive-through window that would potentially serve a restaurant or a bank use. And also, we can also extend that queue lane if the TIA warrants. So as we work through that, we wanted that drive-through to exit to the north such that, you know, after the drive-through window, it would be free-flowing at that point. So
any concern with people turning in and trying to turn left right there at the same time? And it looks pretty close. If it's closer in a building, it's less than 13, 14 feet.
You mean turning into the drive-through space?
No, turning out of the drive-through and turning into the development.
Turning... So they'd be coming into the development and then that exiting movement coming from the drive-through.
Yes.
You mean? Yeah. There would be a stop bar there and a stop sign, obviously, such that, you know, oncoming traffic would have the right-of-way at that point. Yep.
Okay. What do you mean by stop bar?
There'd be, you know, a stop sign and then a stop bar on the actual pavement designated.
Just a pavement lettering?
Yeah. And then a stop sign such that, yeah, that exiting movement would have to make a stop movement,
okay,
analyze oncoming traffic, and then okay, remove. So, yep.
Mr. Monpass, does that clear up anything here? Any other thoughts on that?
Well, I understand what he's saying. I would like to see it in the TIA and see how the movements work out. I would still be concerned at certain times of the day if you've got traffic trying to leave that drive-through and traffic both exiting and entering at that entrance, you're going to get a stack coming out of that drive-through that may be conflicted with it. I think it's something we'll certainly have to look at in the TIA and how they handle it.
Yeah, that's certainly our intent. This is a conceptual design from a flexibility standpoint.
Thank you.
Planometrics would have to be looked at.
Go ahead, Mr. Linder.
Thank you. So I got that one. All right. And then, Mr. Sayer, for the parking, typically we require one stall per apartment. Is that, I guess, did we have that for the units at the bottom? Maybe I was basing off the 284 when actually there's 204 down there right now. Is it, how many parking units are for that?
Yeah, so the code actually has more than that. So if you look at the ordinance, the code requirement for parking is more that or beyond that. But typically for apartment projects, what we've been doing recently is requiring the development to have at least one underground space per unit in the building. So both the mixed-use building along Verona Avenue and the residential building on the south side would meet that requirement.
Okay. All right. A couple other thoughts is I think the buildings look good. I think it's, you know, the renderings look really nice. The breaking up the roof line looks good. The location of apartments, I think, is a good spot, you know, behind it. I like all that. I am hung up on the density. I mean, it's a lot of units. I mean, I know it's 40 units an acre, even if you include the hotel site, which originally was part of it, it'd still be around 30-ish. And that's pretty high. That's kind of high end for us. I think we have only one development ever get above that. And that was a case where they built the apartments and nothing else came after it. So it shouldn't, wasn't planned to be that dense. So that's a major concern. I am appreciative of bringing this forward. Really like the overall idea of the project, but I am questioning the density. And the reason I was asking Mr. Lytle, I'm not sure I got a firm number yet. I'm kind of mulling that over what I'd like to see. It'd probably be easier if we knew the hotel was part of the project too. Give you some advantage to you guys, but the density is something that's concerning to me.
Thank you, Mr. Linder. Mr. Manley, please.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I have a lot of the same feelings here about this project. I'm really glad it's come forward. I think it's a very good project, and it's an exciting project. I agree with what Mr. Linder said about the renderings. I think that it looks great and would be just a tremendous, when you think about what is currently there right now and the opportunity to replace that with something like this, I think it's really exciting for me anyway. I do have a little bit of concern about the density, however, as well. It's extremely dense, and I'd probably be slightly less concerned about the density factor if we are looking at this in isolation, but we're not. I mean, we approved the Steve Brown apartments a little further down West Verona Avenue. I can't remember how many units are coming online as part of that project. And then we've got another 55 units that we're going to be reviewing later on this evening, just a couple blocks away. And I've got concerns in my mind about stacking that many units in one general space. And I also have concerns about how much multifamily the Verona market can even support, which gets to one of the concerns that Mr. Lytle brought up in terms of phasing, and whether or not, I guess there's a concern that I have that if we approve too much multifamily and it gets hard to sell units, what's the first thing that's probably going to get cut from the phasing of a project? And I suspect that it's the commercial piece of it, which is the piece of it that's of the most interest to me, because I think this is a highly developable piece of land for commercial development. So I'd like to see the density come down a little bit as well. I'd be excited to support the project if it did. And I hope that the applicant would consider reducing the density a bit.
Thank you, Mr. Manley. Additional questions, comments? I echo a lot of the same sentiment from the Plan Commission. I think most of you know that I personally feel that at times we're doing too much multifamily. However, having said that, I am really excited about this project, and even though I think the density is a little too high, when I look at the number of parcels that were put together for this project and the significant improvement that we could see on West Verona Avenue, I can get beyond the density if I have assurances that the retail and the commercial will also happen. And I would hope that that would be something that we could discuss as a city with the developer to make sure that those guarantees are in place. And I could support the project if that guarantee was there. Mr. Manley?
To that point, Mr. Mayor, would that guarantee be memorialized in a development agreement, or how would we as a city ensure that that would happen if this moved forward?
And I'm just thinking off the top of my head, but I was thinking that it would be in a developer's agreement, and I would ask the gentleman to my right and left here what they thought about that. But I mean, I think we can be creative in a developer's agreement, and those assurances could be put in place that a guarantee would be there. But I don't know if Jeff or Adam, if you want to speak to that issue.
I'd be fine with putting in the developer's agreement. I mean, we did put some phasing into the Steve Brown apartments project that we approved in November. So there is the option as well. You could put that actually into the GDP of, you know, how you want it to be approved. I mean, you could phase it in the sense of if you had the hotel, or if you have the you know, office building, do you need to have a certain number of units or percentage units kind of be constructed, or I guess square footage of commercial space be constructed concurrently, or build permits pulled at the same time? There's ways you can do that, like you do with Steve Brown Apartments. So that's an option either in the GDP, or it could potentially be in the developer's agreement for this project as well. I mean, part of this project, the city also has to vacate Top Avenue. So, I mean, this isn't the last component of this as well, too. I mean, the city also, just for full disclosure, is we're exploring the creation of a new TIF district in this area to deal with the contamination. So there's a variety of other layers to this project that it's not a... It's a challenging project, partially from the assemblage. It's also challenging because of the contamination. I mean, it's a heavily layered project that isn't a... There's a lot of things that have to be done besides, obviously, GDP and Plan Commission action as well, too. So I guess the bottom line is we could put it in a DA. We could put it here tonight if there's a thought of how this we could possibly structure and phase this as well. There's a variety of options you can look at.
If you wish, please.
Ron Henshu with Ford Development Group, and I'd like to address first and foremost, I think there's a number of places where we can address the to the city plan commission and council satisfaction the pieces that would move this project forward. I want to highlight a couple of things that have been questions that have been asked. First and foremost, when we start with the development, although the financial piece comes into play at some point in time, you start by designing it with a look and feel that is appropriate for the area that it's in. And as we took a look at this area and where it lies within the city, we first designed it to have a feel of complete full with activity and pedestrians walking in the area, going to the retail shops and so forth. We've used the example many times. It's similar. I don't know if you're familiar with Sequoia Commons in Madison, which is more dense than this and more tight, but kind of that feel where you have a neighborhood in and amongst itself. And that's where we started, and I think the architectural renderings gives it that feel. Now, that being said, from that vantage point, then that feel comes with some density. You need some density in order to create that feel and to provide the amount of population that would be needed for those retail locations to survive. And that's why, as we talked about phasing, we would start with the multifamily, because we would need some, you know, activity density there in order to make the commercial retail go. Now, when you take that and go to the next step, the assemblage of the number of properties that were necessary to get this project going, the environmental remediation that everybody's aware of is on this property, and some assistance that's needed, that density is also needed to support the project financially. So it started with the design and the feel, and ultimately we then took that feel and designed the density into it that wouldn't be needed to support the project financially. So it's the combination of those that really we believe is creating the project with the feel and the type of project that would be good for this area of the city.
Any questions for Ron, as long as he's up? Mr. Heinzen, please.
Mr. Mayor. I have, I guess that my opinion is very similar to the mayor's. It's a great project. I'm not terribly troubled by the density. That won't come as a surprise to the folks in the Plan Commission here. What I am concerned about, though, is the commercial ever getting built, and what assurances can you give the city that those retail commercial spaces are going to show up? And I guess just to comment on trying to make an agreement or a developer's agreement, having some provision that would require those commercial buildings being built at some point. Had we had one in the agreement with West End folks, I can't believe that would have been sufficient to have them build those buildings nonetheless. I mean, they would have walked away from the project, it seems like, at least with how they came before us. And so that's a very significant concern of the city. And do you have any comments on that?
Well, I think as we proceed down the path and discuss all of the aspects that are necessary that as the developer, that we'd be not only fully engaged, but interested in discussing whatever the options are that you may consider as a city to provide those assurances. And what, as we're moving through this process, we're trying to provide all the information we have and have provided much of it to city staff already in regards to the overall project and its costs and the layout and how we would proceed. And I think in amongst those conversations, we're interested in doing what we can to help with those assurances to the best of our ability. One other thing I want to highlight here that in terms of the density and what's equally as important as the density is the ability to absorb that density within the marketplace. And we just recently received a market research. We don't proceed in any area that we develop in without research that would indicate that what we're proposing is developable, acceptable. And we'll provide this information to city staff as we go through, but we just received the market research that indicates that, first of all, they're projecting that you'd be able to absorb approximately 12 units per month in this area. That's actually currently being absorbed. It's not in Verona, it's in Fitchburg, but it's probably the closest project to this area is absorbing right now at the tune of 12 units per month. So you take a look at that, we'd be phasing this, so it would be a multi-phase, multi-year project. But also there's about 535 units that would be needed in the primary market area per year over the next 5 years is what the research study is saying. So there's demand out there, and the demand as it relates to the Verona area itself would be absorbed at about those 12 units per month is what the study's saying.
Mr. Heinzen, did you have a follow-up?
Yes, thank you. Is it too early to have already spoken with some possible tenants of the commercial buildings? I mean, do you have an idea of who might be interested?
I cannot say that we have specific users at this point. We've talked with a number of individuals who are familiar with the area, and there is tenant interest already. We're really early in the process, so we haven't, to be honest with you, we haven't tried to ferret out and determine the how real that interest is, but we know there is interest out there.
Mr. Linder, please.
Mr. Henshu, is that right? So what, we talk about density. Mr. Lytle was proposing 50 units less. What are your thoughts on that? I mean, you've got four of us here that out of the seven that kind of questioning the density, or six, sorry.
Our preference would be to proceed ahead with the density that we propose, because we know that density from a financial standpoint helps to move the project along. And there is, as part of our overall request, there is some assistance that we're requesting from the city as it relates to environmental remediation and as it relates to the potential for other types of financing. So what I can state is that if the density was lowered, it will put more pressure or need on the financing assistance. Mm-hmm. So that being said, we could go back and take a look at that, but I know that's what the end result would be.
Go ahead, Mr. Linder.
Just to follow up on that, I mean, I don't know. I'll speak for myself. I really like to see this going forward, but I'm really struggling with that. It's just so much more than we've done before. It sets a precedent for us. It'll affect a lot of future developments, and it's a lot of units in one spot, quite frankly. The other thing I want to follow up, well, maybe you asked Mr. Henshu who's done, but I had a question on the developer's agreement, too, how that would work, but okay. Looks like Mr. Heinzen has something for
Mr.
the
Heinzen?
Developer.
Sure, if I could just follow up, Jack. Maybe we go back to what the purpose of the density is. And part of it, I think, is not to have too many apartments come onto the market at the same time. But
if you, I take a look at this property where the apartments would be built, and it's not in a residential area. So this density is density all to itself. There isn't, with the exception of some additional apartment buildings coming on, but It is, you know, next door is, there would be the hotel. Next to that is St. Vincent's, and then another hotel. So it's not an area that has much other residential density, and I think that's one reasonable way in which to differentiate this project from other projects in the city as far as making precedence in the future.
Okay. Go ahead.
Can I follow up on my other questions?
Sure, so can. Go ahead, Mr. Linder.
Back to the phasing, I'm still struggling on how you'd make that work. I mean, if they build all these apartments and then they say, we don't have the money, what are you gonna do?
Mr. Sarah, please.
Well, I mean, like I said, you could build something into the GDP or, you know, obviously we're in discussions regarding potential incentives for the project. There's ways you can look at that agreement and, you know, encourage certain things to happen in certain ways as well. So, I mean, there's a variety of ways, you know, that you can kind of look at that. So, I mean, so I know the West End was brought up as potential as an example of, you know, if we would have had those insurances, part would have been moot anyways, and you're probably right. I think in this situation, the difference is that obviously we're talking a potential new TIF district in this area that kind of makes the conversation a little bit different from that standpoint of the West End never had that. The West End was just the developer's agreement for the public improvements in the road itself. So, I mean, like, there's not a clean answer. And the bottom line is it's not a clean answer because if you put those in place, if you say it's got to be X, Y, and Z, if it's that rigid and strict enough, that has potential to hamper development. But in the same breath, it doesn't get to the Planning Commission's concerns as well of you've got too much here and you potentially might build too many units or not. You might build all this stuff and the rest might not happen.
Yeah.
Same situation that we had in the West End. So how do you grapple with that? I mean, my recommendation is, for better or for worse, I think it should be in part in the developer's agreement in this situation. I think there's greater teeth in that and greater potential to make that happen. I think we all know, speaking of myself, Mr. Mikorski and the mayor, and even Mr. Linder as well, who sits in the council, there's ways you can do it in the developer's agreement. I think that could be better handled. That's regarding the phasing itself. The number, I guess that's more of a conversation for this body, but the phasing I think we can handle cleanly in there.
Go ahead, Mr. Linder.
So just to clarify then, not necessarily force them to happen, but encourage, you know, put in some language and some incentives or to encourage this other development that, not that I guess you can't 100% make it for sure, but you know, you can encourage. Is that kind of what you're getting at, is make it more likely to happen?
Correct. There's a I don't want to go into too many details, but there's a variety of ways you can structure that and how an incentive works.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. Heinzen, please.
Sure. I guess it can you remind me of what the phasing anticipated is right now as far as yearly moving forward?
Well, as we had indicated in our submittal, that the multi-family residential would go first.
Both buildings though?
No, we within that multi-family going first, we could potentially have some phasing occurring, meaning not the entire 200 plus units coming on at the same time. That's as we submitted, we indicated that would go first. We're waiting for the market study to be received to actually determine the pace at which we would bring that on, because obviously for the benefit of everybody, you want to bring on the appropriate number of units that can be absorbed within a reasonable period. So there could be a sub phase to the multifamily, but then if things go according to our plan, we would anticipate that the first piece that's likely to go could be the hotel, actually, even though in front of us that is not here today, but that there is, we're working on that in the background, and that could actually move the quickest. And then the multifamily, and then the office retail versus mixed use, it would just depend on user and timing and activity in the market. Okay.
Mr. Henson?
Sure, thank you. Can you put months or years to what you would anticipate as far as the hotel, as an example? Is this something that...
What I could indicate is that would likely to be something that would occur within the next 12 months.
Okay.
Mr. Hansen?
Just a question for Adam, or I guess maybe everybody in the Planning Commission, is the one thing that may be very helpful, very helpful, it would be somewhat helpful, would be to include in developer's agreement that those properties that are along the road have to be landscaped while we wait for commercial buildings to be put up, because, you know, I look again at what we're looking at the West End, and it would be more appealing certainly to the city if we could have some of that property very aesthetically looking. Yeah.
Mr. Manley, did you have your hand up?
I did, thank you. We've sort of alluded to a couple of times the possibility for financial assistance related to the environmental remediation. Can you talk about the extent of what help is needed and what type of assistance is necessary, and whether or not you think the project is viable without some type of assistance?
I can indicate that the project is not viable without financial assistance. We're in the process of working through trying to refine and clarify those numbers right now, of which we're summarizing those in two buckets for the city. One would be the environmental piece itself. The other would be any additional assistance that would be needed. But what I can state is that it would not move forward without financial assistance.
Mr. Sayre?
I just kind of want to piggyback on that, and just the contamination itself, the gas station, that site is a closed site by the DNR. So there is still product, there's still things underground at the gas station, but it's closed by the DNR, but as soon as you basically stick a shovel in the ground, that's when it opens back up and has to be remediated. You have the same or similar situation on the hotel site as well. My understanding, you can correct me if I'm wrong, but that hotel would be built similar to the Holiday Inn Express, where that is on a cap site, and you wouldn't be disturbing the soil. So that potentially could go. Part of the reason that can go quicker is because you're not digging down for all that underground parking. So that would just go on top of the contamination or the cap site that's there right now, and could happen a lot quicker. But the rest of the site, there is a, if you look online with the DNR brownfield documents, there is a plume area, if we'll call it, that there is a known contamination area that spreads kind of from the middle of the property here and balloons kind of north and south a little bit as well too. So there is it is known from the standpoint of a closure site. It's there, and it's the fact that there's underground parking does complicate it even more, the fact that it's underground, because you have to dig out and excavate a further amount, and then ultimately you have vapor mitigation in there as well too. I'm not sure if that helps kind of answer what the extent of the contamination is.
Thank you. Mr. Horsfall first, and then Mr.
Great. Thanks. You had said that the retail needs to go first because of the economics. And again, I think that's developer 101. Every developer that's come here has said that exact same thing. With that said, if there's a desire, I mean, you make your money because of the number of apartments charged at a certain rental. So if there's less apartments, can you charge higher rent to have the economics work out the same? And that's a question, I don't know what the answer is, and I don't know how that has to do with planning, but I'm just curious for the answer.
The answer to that is no. The rate that you can charge for a particular unit is the same whether you have 10 units or whether you have 200 units. The difference is the cost in the construction is, as you have more units, your cost per unit generally goes down. So therefore, it allows you to then, at whatever that rental rate is, have a little better coverage.
If there's a high demand, why can't you charge higher rents? That doesn't mean, you just said that there's a big demand for apartments, that if there's the same number of apartments or less number of apartments, but you can charge more per apartment, doesn't you develop the economics that way also?
Yeah, when I say there's a high demand, there's demand, it's a continuing demand. So it's not that there's users out there right now who would rent and there's no apartments available. There are ones that are available right now that they can move into. But the demand will continue, obviously, as the market expands. So there's continuing demand.
Thanks.
Mr. Heinzen?
Thank you, Ms. Mayor. Just a couple more questions in connection with the environmental remediation. Are the contracts that you have to acquire the properties, do they include your assumption of the environmental liability for those sites, or does that stay with the owner so that we can look at the owners of those properties currently to be paying for the remediation?
No, they would flow to the new owner.
Okay.
So, for example, the one site which has been closed by the DNR can sit there and stay closed and nothing needs to be done, but as soon as you choose to develop it further, then that and you open the site up is when you're exposed again to that. So therefore, that does enter into the price that you would purchase property for.
So you're able to purchase the property for some reasonable amount, significant amount less than it would sell for if it wasn't contaminated.
Correct. Okay. Correct.
Do you have an idea of how much it's going to cost to remediate that site?
There's a lot of unknowns. I can tell you that we've received an estimate as high as I believe it is two. Yeah. So just on
How much was that?
Just on the one site by itself, we've received an estimate that it could be as high as $3 to $4 million on the one site. Now we don't know some of the sites that surround the site that we know there's contamination on have never been tested. You don't know whether or not any of that material has flowed to other properties, but that's part of the process that will occur as the property is developed.
Go ahead, Mr. Heinz.
Just to follow up, do you know whether or not the current owner of that site would have liability for the contamination that leaked to the site surrounding it that are under different ownership that we could look to that owner for payment?
There is no way to look to that owner for that payment if it has leached onto those other sites.
Judgment proof, doesn't
yeah.
it? Okay. Okay, thank you.
Mr. Lytle, please.
So it seems to me that it's good we're having this discussion at the GDP phase. It seems like there's a contingent of us that understand that the density you're proposing is required to make this viable, to support the other uses. I think our concern is how to create some certainty on the city's part that we don't end up with a residential-only development on the site. I know you've put some fair bit of thought and analysis into the current layout as it exists. One compromise that occurs to me is by pushing 50 to 80 of these units into the mixed-use buildings and shrinking the size of the residential only, that serves both purposes. I know you have to weigh the costs of those units versus the cost of a larger residential unit, but that would be one area that I think you should weigh the pros and cons of, or both parties should weigh the pros and cons of having the additional dwelling units linked to the good stuff from our perspective, which is the mixed use and the commercial, versus them being completely separate and the potential for a residential only.
Other comments? Mr. Heinzen, please.
Sure. Just another one with respect to the environmental cleanup. I'm not sure where the property lines are divided, but is it your intention to clean up the property before putting any buildings on any of the property that's been acquired?
Yes.
Okay.
Let me comment on one other thing, and we are reaching out to, there is a grant that is available to assist with that, which we are reaching out, and we've talked with the city staff about as well, because it requires both parties' involvement on it. So we're doing everything we can to seek out those areas where you can to reduce costs and to be reimbursed for costs incurred.
Other questions, comments, potential motions? We closed the public hearing, so unless you're representing the developer, so we'd be happy after the meeting if you have a question that would help us for further discussion, or there may be opportunities. Adam, will this be on the agenda for next week, Monday, for council? So we can't do that, otherwise we create problems down the road with precedent. Mr. Heinzen, please.
Sure, question I think primarily for Mr. Sayre. Remind us what we are agreeing to do if we were to approve the this tonight. We addressed a lot of issues here. We had, you know, density and environmental contamination and having that cleaned up, and the, you know, the order in which the buildings have to get built. So it would be helpful, at least for me, to know whether, you know, which pieces of what we talked about tonight we can still address in the future, or do we have to deal with them right now before we consider this.
Mr. Sayre?
Well, I mean, it's ultimately up to what the Plan Commission wants to deal with. But I mean, regarding the density, I mean, if you approve a number in there, you know, that's probably the number you're going to probably get. I think it's probably up to discussion and debate in the future, if, which I think you could, though. But you could potentially shift those units around, as Mr. Lytle suggested, to the building along Vernon Avenue and reducing the one on the back. You could potentially do that. The phasing. You know, that one, if it's not a condition of approval, could potentially be dealt with in a developer's agreement. So that's up to the discretion of kind of the what the plan how strong the Plan Commission feels about that. And I think that the challenge with that is how restrictive is it, and how does that actually limit development potential because of what the phasing is. Contamination will kind of work itself out when on the developer's end as they go through that process as well. So I think the big ones that I'm hearing, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, but is the phasing and then the density concerns that are out there right now. I think the big one that we can deal with definitely is going to be the phasing. I think we can easily handle that in the developer's agreement. I'm not concerned about that. I think the density, that's the one I'm going to ultimately defer to the Plan Commission here what your thoughts are on that. If it's not 284, you know, I guess what is the number? I mean, right now we're at 40 and a half dwelling units per acre, and that does not include the hotel site. If you put the hotel site in, it comes down to about 32 per acre. But you know, density in itself is just the function of units and area. I mean, you have the West End Apartments, which was alluded to. That one has a density of 40 units per acre because it sits on 2.6 acres of land. So, I don't know. I mean, from a planning perspective, you know, when you start looking at the buildings itself, my feeling always is I personally try not to get too hung up on what the density is. You look at what the buildings look like, you look at the height and scale of the buildings, and you kind of ask the question, does it fit? I mean, ultimately, that's the first question you kind of have to ask yourself. And then you back yourself kind of into that number of, okay, am I comfortable with the number that's kind of out there, and does it work with how they're designing and making this work? So where that falls is the question, but that's always kind of how I look at it, of more of a function of design versus, like I said, I try not to get too hung up on the actual number itself, because ultimately, in the end of the day, you're not going to ever see that number. You're going to see hopefully a high quality project that's going to be sitting there for many years. And that's my opinion, I guess. But those are the two items I think the Plan Commission is kind of grappling with right now. And I think you can deal with them, but it depends on how you guys want to.
Mr. Linder, please.
I'm more comfortable with the phasing right now. So it is density. And
still struggling. But I did have one other question that popped up in my head as we were looking at the near map you got up there is, who owns that Top Avenue? What's left of Top Avenue? Is that city or is that private?
So right now, we obviously it's right away, so the city owns it. We'd have to vacate that. As of right now, what the applicant is kind of showing here is potentially having some type of a driveway coming in. That was a concern that we had at the last meeting. There was a large, very large cul-de-sac plan there that the city has no interest in having as a public road. So this would be a potential private driveway that serves one property.
Okay.
The property itself actually currently has frontage on Legion Street. So when you vacate right away, typically half of it goes to the one property on the other side there, half goes to the other side. So potentially this lot here, this lot here would pick up some additional land with that vacation as well too, and there could be the potential of putting that driveway in as part of that vacation, or even leaving part of that road and maybe just adding a curb someplace as well too. There's some options we could take a look at.
Thank you.
Other feedback, questions? Mr. Manley, please.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Just a question for staff, because it seems pretty clear that the project couldn't move forward without some type of assistance. And I know that we've heard TIF assistance used. Is there a restriction on the use of TIF for projects that are predominantly residential? Or is there, if I remember correctly, there's some type of a limitation on in our TIF law that speaks to a certain percentage of a project that's residential. I just want to make sure that that's put into consideration. Do we know what that is?
Mr. Sir?
Off the top of my head, I don't have that. I know Ehlers right now is working on kind of the initial details of the project plan. It would be a blighted TIF because of the contamination. It also would be a mixed use TIF as well because of the hotel and the mixed use building and the office building as well. But that's something we could check with Ehlers on, but they do most of the TIFs around the state, it seems, and we'll flush that one out pretty quick if that's an issue out there. But we've shared this initially with Ehlers, and they haven't raised that issue to us yet. But I'll check tomorrow.
Okay. Thank you.
Mr. Linder, please.
Thank you. Just a point of process. If this is voted upon and it is does not pass, it still goes to the council on Monday?
Mr. Sir?
Well, if it's a negative recommendation, I believe it would. If it's a 3-3 tie, that's where I always think in the past we've had that before, and I think if it's a tie, I don't believe it comes out of the committee. I believe there'd have to be some type of positive or negative recommendation. I'm not sure if the mayor wants to weigh in your experience with that.
We'd have to take a look at our I don't know off the top of my head. I'm sorry about that, Jack.
But I do know that if it's a positive or negative, it would go forward. But if it was a, say, 3-3 vote.
My gut reaction is that a 3-3 vote is a failed vote, and that it could still come to the council on Monday night. But we would have to verify that. Mr. Mikarski?
There's three in a row. Yeah, I was going to say, I think in order for it to go to council, there's got to be a majority in one direction, if I recall. I do believe there's needs to be a majority.
We'd have to check on that. Mr. Heinzen.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I would just, reiterate to the commission here with respect to the density that it is, I think, a reasonable, if not a preferred way to look at the density is to look at not just the land that is owned by the developer here, but all of the land that is in this area, which is very low density in residential. I think that the project itself looks great. It will you know, result in contamination being lost or being taken away, future property taxes. I think it's a great addition to the city and this part of the city in particular. I don't think that density should be a primary concern, particularly in this part of the city.
Thank you, Mr. Heinzen. Mr. Lytle, please.
I guess if there's some wish to get a read of the different members of the Plan Commission, I am not in a position that I would support this proposal this evening. I think I made some of the areas I was concerned about clear, and I'm not, I mean, obviously there's, you would prefer to have an upvote tonight and move forward this month, but as it is, I would not be voting for it.
Mr. Sarah, please.
So regarding the process, if you don't mind me jumping back to that.
Go ahead.
So what the ordinance says is that PUDs are reviewed in the same manner as conditional use permits. And what this says is the Common Council shall not approve a conditional use, in this case PUD, without allowing for a recommendation from the Plan Commission per the provisions of this subsection. So in my opinion, if it's a 3-3 vote, it's not a recommendation. And what it looks like is within 60 days, there has to be a if the Plan Commission fails to make a report within 60 days of the filing of the said complete application, then the Common Council may hold a public hearing within 30 days after the expiration of the 60-day period. Failure to receive said written report from the Plan Commission per subsection above shall not invalidate the preceding actions of the Common Council. So I guess reading that, my opinion is that we need to have some type of recommendation either way to the Common Council. If it doesn't get a recommendation, we go back, check the submittal date, count the days, and it potentially would come back to the Plan Commission again, or potentially go to the plan to the council with a public hearing.
Thank you, Mr. Sir. Other thoughts, comments? Mr. Manley.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I really like this project, and I do want it to move forward, but I'm not sure that I'm all the way there yet in terms of some of the unanswered questions I have about the density and other projects that we're reviewing that will impact the viability of this level of intensity for multifamily within our city. I don't want to stop the progress on this project because I think it's a great project. But I also don't know that I'm prepared to give it entitlement tonight, because that's essentially what we're doing with the GDP. I almost wish we had just a little bit more time to vet some of these issues, but I understand that the applicant wants to move forward, and I don't blame them for that. Is there any way this is going to the Common Council, whether it's a no or it's a yes, it's going to the Common Council next week, correct? Okay, thank you.
Mr. Henshu, can I ask you a question? A 30-day delay, if we were to take no action this evening to you, does that put you in danger of losing any of the options on the property?
Can I have a few seconds?
Sure.
Just to clarify your point, Mr. Manley, yes, if it's a negative or a positive recommendation, it would. If it's a tie, that's where it creates the issue. If it's a 3-3 vote, that's the issue.
A 30-day delay would not jeopardize the project, and if it's needed in order to continue to move it forward, we'd accept that delay and work to satisfy some of the questions that are being asked tonight.
Thank you. Mr. Linder?
I just want to say thanks to the developer for currently agreeing to that. If that's what's going to happen tonight, I think that would be a great option to maybe vet some of the density and a few other questions we had tonight.
Any other thoughts, comments, concerns? Without any motions, unless there are any motions, we would put this back on the agenda for the March meeting. Mr. Horsfall?
I'm going to make a motion.
Okay.
And again, 30-day delay is okay, but if you don't change the density or if nothing else changed on the plans, except for the traffic study or whatever it is, I think we're going to come back to the same spot, so 30 days isn't going to do anything one way or the other. Anyways, at this time, I'd like to recommend that the Common Council approve the general development plan for the Sugar Creek Commons with the following conditions. Prior to submittal of the PIP, a TIA shall be completed by the and approved by the city staff. The GDP shall become, number two, the GDP shall become effective upon Forward Development Group acquiring the properties identified within the GDP submittal.
Do we have a second to the motion? Is there a second to the motion?
Okay.
Go ahead, Ms. Linder.
I'm trying to follow where you were yet.
Just one and two.
What did it change from what was in the packet?
Nothing. I just make the recommendation to the council.
Is there a second to the motion? Is there a second to the motion? Seeing none, the motion fails. Without objection, we will put this on the agenda for the March meeting. Thank you, everyone. We are on agenda item number 7, which is discussion and possible action. If we were to take action, it would be a recommendation to the Common Council on a certified survey map to create one lot south of West Verona Avenue, west of West End Circle, and east of Wall Street. Mr. Sarah, if you would, please.
Can I back up just a second? Is this going to be talked about, or this last item going to be talked about at the council?
Would not be.
No. No. Okay, thank you.
Mr. Sarah, please.
Thank you. The applicant is requesting approval of a CSM to create one lot in the West End. This is the Steve Brown Apartments project that was approved by the Planning Commission and Council in November. As a condition of approval of that project, they were to combine these two parcels into one and designate the existing driveway as a fire lane. In your packet is a CSM, which shows lot one and also has the fire lane or the 23-foot wide existing driveway designated as a fire lane. The intent of this is to that the city then can enforce parking and potentially tow vehicles when they are parked in this area. As part of this, the city will need to modify with the developer an existing shared access easement that serves these properties. The developer is aware of this and has no concerns with that modification. The city attorney and staff are working on that modification, that easement, as we speak. Staff has no concerns with the CSM. It's consistent with the condition of approval for the project. So that staff recommends the Plan Commission recommend to the Common Council approval of the CSM to create one lot in the West End with the following condition: that one, the shared access easement identified on the CSM shall be modified to allow the city to enforce parking on the easement.
Thank you, Mr. Sayre. Questions, comments? Potential motions? Mr. Sayre?
I guess one more thing to add. The applicant is in the process of pulling building permits for the entire property. So all the buildings, they pull a permit at once for it. So they are still anticipating to break ground here in the spring.
All right, thank you. Questions, comments, potential motions? Mr. Lytle, please.
Yes, I'll make a motion that the Plan Commission recommend Common Council approve the CSM to create the one lot in West End with the condition as noted in the staff report regarding modifying the shared access easement.
We have a motion by Mr. Lytle. Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Mr. Heinzen. Questions or comments on the motion? Questions or comments? Seeing none, all those in favor of the motion signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, no. And that motion carries. We are on
Agenda item number 8, which is discussion and possible action regarding initial plat review for proposed 11-lot single-family subdivision to be located east of North Nine Mound Road on Apollo Road. Mr. Sayre, if you would, please.
Thank you. The applicant is requesting review of a conceptual subdivision. This is the land that's located on East Nine Mound Road, or excuse me, east of North Nine Mound Road, south of Kranz Electric. The land itself is part of the old Cross Point plat. That was the plat. It was actually platted in 2004. The Cross Point plat is actually now owned by Epic, the rest of the land. This is the remnant piece that was left over. So before you right now is the plat that was actually approved. The land to the west was purchased by Epic and vacated as part of that process, I believe, in 2010 and 2013. So the chunk that we're talking about here tonight is the kind of the piece that's left over here. It was platted as 6 single-family parcels, and the gray one was platted as a multi-family parcel. The applicant is here tonight requesting just conceptual feedback regarding an 11-lot plat, and also would it have one outlot for stormwater purposes. In general, the configuration is relatively the same of what was previously platted on the property. As part of the process, the applicant would need to rezone the property from the current classification of neighborhood residential and urban residential to entirely neighborhood residential. So it would be a single family subdivision. Access to the site would be from Nine Mound Road through the newly constructed Apollo Road as part of the project. Access from Nine Mount would be restricted. We would also restrict some of the access along the corner here to ensure that whatever house is built on lot 11, that their driveway would be pushed the furthest east as possible. As part of the project as well, the applicant will need to make improvements to North Nine Mount Road on the east side. That includes curb, gutter, and sidewalk. There would also be sidewalk installed within the project itself up to Kranz Electric. Kranz Electric is currently located in the town. If it were to ever develop in the city at that point, additional sidewalk and curb and gutter would be installed at that point. The applicant is here tonight. We're just kind of looking for Plan Commission feedback and comments. Their intention is, if it goes well, to come back quickly with a preliminary and final plat and hopefully get the project started here at some point in 17. So with that, I'd be happy to answer any questions you have, or the applicant would be happy to answer any questions as well.
Questions or comments from Plan Commission members? Questions, comments, or feedback? Mr. Horswell, please.
What's the minimum size lot for neighborhood residential?
8,000 square feet.
Go ahead.
Just the comment, lot 9 looks tough to build on. It looks like you're kind of trying to jam 11 lots into something that would make more sense that have maybe 9. That's just comment looking at it, but that's all.
Okay. Mr. Manley, please.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Just looking at the aerial picture of the property there, is there a concern with the current structure that's on the Kranz property in its proximity to what would be the newly constructed Apollo Road?
Mr. Sarah, please.
There's no concern from a constructability standpoint, the
setback, anything?
Well, the setback, yeah, I mean, it's not going to conform to wherever the town setback is. Regardless, I'm not sure what the town setback is, but it's not going to meet that. It looks like it's going to be very close to that property line. But with that said, I mean, there's the property. This is basically not developable. If that, if there's an issue with that, that hinders it undevelopable because of that. But this has been platted. Currently, it's platted right now. So Apollo Road, the Apollo Court here, whatever it's legal name is, that's been platted since 2004. So right now, if someone came in and purchased this property, they could actually build this with a developer's agreement. So it's there already, for better or for worse.
Go ahead, Mr. Manley.
I guess just as a follow-up, I'm supportive of the concept that's been brought forward. I think it you know, obviously we have a pretty significant demand for single family lots in the city, and we've got some coming online hopefully in 2017 in the north neighborhood. But I think having a few more in another location is desirable, so it's something that I would be very comfortable supporting.
Thank you, Mr. Manley. Any additional feedback, comments? Mr. Linder?
Thank you, Mayor. Residential here I think is fine, and the only thing I would say is that I kind of agree with the initial comments that maybe the lots 8, 9, 10, 11 are, the lines aren't probably where they probably need to be. Maybe even one less lot might make them fit better, but that'd be my feedback.
Thank you, Mr. Linder. Other comments? I would just echo the comments that I've heard here before. I'm supportive of what I'm seeing here as well as having that developed. Seeing no other comments, we look forward to seeing this again in the future. Thank you. We are on agenda item number nine, which is discussion and possible action on the initial site plan review for a proposed 12,400 square foot daycare center to be located on lot 25 of Liberty Business Park. And if we were to take action this evening, this would be a plan commission action item. Or no action, I'm sorry. Mr. Sayre, please. Initial review.
Thank you. The request tonight is for an initial review of a 12,400 square foot daycare facility to be located on lot 25 of Liberty Park. The lot in question is highlighted on the screen before you. For reference purposes, this is the same lot that has the current two flex industrial buildings. Those flex buildings would be located immediately north of the daycare. The proposed daycare center will provide childcare. Will provide childcare for services to 152 children from ages birth to five. This does require a conditional use permit, and also requires for the use, and also for the fact that there be multiple buildings on one parcel, which is then classified as a group development. The project would also require site plan approval from the Plan Commission and the replatting of Lazier Street, which I will get into in a few minutes. From a bulk standpoint, the proposed building would be set back approximately 91 feet from the existing configuration of Lazier Street, and would be set back approximately 25 feet from the potential future location of Lazier Street. As part of the project, the applicant would like to replat and basically move where the future Lazier Street would be located. Lazier Street was planned to, you can see on this map, basically start extending southeast into the adjacent property. The applicant would like to, instead of having the bend there, extend Lazier to so it pretty much heads straight east. Access to the site would be from the current Lazier Street. As part of the project, the applicant would need to extend Lazier to the property line. The property line is the green line on the site plan to the east. With that as well, they would have to replat the road if there's a desire from the council and planning commission to change the configuration of the road. It would have to be replatted and go through the process as identified in the ordinances and statute. Initially, staff is comfortable with the straightening of the road itself, so long as we kind of go through the appropriate steps. Parking, the applicant is proposing 62 parking spaces. 56 are required by ordinance. There would be 25 employees in the largest shift for the daycare. Initially, staff has no concerns with the parking itself. One comment is that staff would like to see at least a pedestrian connection into the buildings to the north, or ideally some type of drive connection to kind of hook those parking lots together, just to increase the connectivity. There are a couple fitness locations in those flex buildings, and it would be nice to have people the opportunity to drop their kids off and then ultimately go work out next door. From a design standpoint, the applicant is proposing to use stone veneer, ephes, and fiberglass columns. The design is similar to other buildings within the park. The colors are also similar as well. Initially, staff has no concerns with the design of the building. There is an outdoor play area planned on the east side of the project as well. The site doesn't abut any residential, and staff has no concerns initially with that outdoor play area. The applicant is here tonight. I'm sure he'd be happy to answer any of your questions. So staff recommends the Plan Commission review the submitted materials and provide feedback to the applicant.
Thank you, Mr. Sayre. Do we have comments, any feedback? Mr. Manley, please.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. My first reaction was, wow, another childcare. but I assume that the demand is there. I thought the building looked nice. I didn't have any concerns with the proposed architecture. It seems at least somewhat similar in design to the daycare that we've approved off of East Verona Avenue. I forget the name of it, but I think it looks like a nice project and something that I'm supportive of.
Thank you, Mr. Manley. Mr. Horsfall, please.
With that said, are we tracking the number of daycares? Not that, I mean, do other cities have similar number of daycares per capita?
Mr. Sarah.
I'm not tracking them. There have been a lot. Kind and Joyful behind the Pizza Ranch obviously has not gone forward. I'm not sure if it's going to go forward, but we've had a lot, and I think we'll be having more in the future as well. I'm not sure why. I've asked the question of a couple operators. Is it because of Epic? Is it because of that? And the last time I asked the question, the operator said no, it wasn't. It was coming from zip codes and kind of the west side of Madison, especially. So I don't know. My initial assumption was kind of okay. Epic is getting older, and this. But the last person I asked that question to kind of said no. That's not the case.
Other feedback. Mr. Lytle, please.
So I'm just trying to recall. There's a lot more traffic, I assume, on Liberty Drive, and we'll be seeing a lot more in the next year. Will we have a need, Mr. Montpass, for signal at Liberty Drive? Was there ever a plan to have a signal at Liberty Drive and Highway M? I'm just thinking peak times when people are dropping off kids or picking up kids combined with whatever, people leaving work from that area. Or is that driven by traffic counts and queue times and that kind of thing?
Mr. Montpass?
I'm not entirely certain whether signals were planned for that. I know that the Public Works Department is looking at a couple of TIAs down there. I think this is one of the intersections because directly to the south is the Verona Tech Park. And that is on the in the planning for Public Works possibly this year, and then further to the east with the potential for that development with CDI is also another TIA. So yes, traffic signals eventually will be needed there, whether they're this year or in the next five, I don't know. That'll depend on what the TIA says.
Mr. Linder, please.
No. Okay. I just want to say I think it looks nice. I don't have a problem with Laser Street being straightened. And I would encourage also a connectivity to the Flex Seal building. We've had in a few other cases kind of by the fast food row, so to speak, on Rowan Avenue. Connectivity just makes getting around a little bit easier. And I don't see a problem with people overusing another person's driveway. It's just getting around makes it a little bit easier for a few people here and there. So feedback.
Thank you, Mr. Linder. Other feedback? I would just echo the comments. I think the building looks very nice, and I didn't have anything to add. Any other comments? If not, we look forward to seeing this again in a future time. Next, we are on discussion and possible action regarding planned unit concept plan located at 114 South Main Street and 108 Park Lane. The proposed PUD would allow for the construction of approximately 18,000 square feet of commercial space and 55 apartment units. Mr. Sayre, please.
Thank you. The request tonight is a plan development concept plan review. The properties in question is the former World of Variety property, which is on South Main Street. and also the existing Ace Hardware property, which is at the corner of Schumann and West Rhone Avenue. The proposed project would add approximately 18,000 square feet of commercial space and 55 apartment units for the site itself. The sites would have two separate buildings. There'd be a two-phase process to construct this. Phase one would be the demolition of the former World of Variety and the construction of a new building along South Main Street. Along with phase one, there'd be a new building at the corner of Schumann and Verona Avenue, both of these mixed use with commercial on the first and apartments above. Phase two then would be Ace Hardware then shifting into this previously constructed space here, and then there'd be another Ace, the former Ace would be demolished, and then there'd be an additional addition off the back of that as well. From a bulk standpoint and setback standpoint, both the buildings provide a strong presence along Main Street and West Verona Avenue. Staff has requested some modifications to the setbacks of the buildings. For the building that's along Main Street, staff has requested that building be set back 15 feet from the existing right-of-way. The intent of that is if ever in the future the city were to need to expand that roadway, that would give us the potential capacity to purchase and acquire that right-of-way to expand the roadway. It's more of just a placeholder of we potentially could need that in the future. The second modification that we've requested is for the building at the corner of Schumann and Verona Avenue. We've requested that additional, actually 15 feet of right-of-way be dedicated at this time, and that would then accommodate the near-term expansion of Verona Avenue in this location. Parking, the applicant is proposing 121 on-site parking spaces. That includes 74 at the surface and 47 spaces underground. A complete parking analysis has not been completed at this time. One recommendation that staff will have is similar to other projects. We'll recommend that there be one underground space per unit in each of the buildings. As part of the project, the applicant is proposing to vacate the actual Park Lane, which is located between South Main and Schumann Street. The applicant is proposing to add angled parking in the former Park Lane. Staff is comfortable with the vacation of this. I think there's a couple of comments that we've had initially is that there's some existing utilities within that roadway that we would require easements to. Further, the applicant would need to accommodate the existing truck traffic and turning movements from Miller's and Sons. That potentially might result in the loss of some of the parking spaces. What we've told the applicant is the basically kind of hold tight the existing turning movements that are out there right now to ensure those trucks can back in and back out of that loading dock area. That's something that we can work with the applicant on if the project goes forward. The applicant is proposing to keep the existing access point from West Verona Avenue. That is a shared access point with Park Bank. The applicant also is proposing to keep the existing access point on South Main as well. Staff has encouraged the applicant to close this or restrict this to a right-in, right-out just because of the close proximity to that intersection. I think the challenge with that one is that it's actually shared by a couple different property owners, and I think Park Bank has some concerns about potentially closing that access point. But staff has encouraged the applicant to at least continue to explore that as an option. Staff also does recommend that Park Lane be restricted to a right-in, right-out, once again trying to restrict those movements onto South Main Street. The design itself, the applicant is proposing a four-story building along South Main Street. The building along West Verona Avenue would be three stories. The proposed height of the building on South Main is approximately 50 feet tall. The applicant is proposing to use stone veneer, fiber cement siding, and laminate siding. Staff has recommended the applicant swap the stone veneer for a brick material instead. The brick is a more dominant and common material. It's been used in the downtown itself and will provide a better match and fit to other buildings. Staff also recommends the applicant step back the fourth floor of the building itself. So that takes the top floor and actually steps it back and usually puts a patio or a outside area. That would reduce the scale kind of the height itself, but also would reduce the potential tunneling effect in this area when you have a four-story building. And finally, staff recommends the applicant review the design features of the Sequoia Commons development in Madison. And that one has blended well with the neighborhood of Madison. If there's a way to look at that project and review some of the features there, it'd be great. The building that would be at Schumann and West Verona Avenue, once again, would be three stories. You'd have the first floor being the commercial retail portion of it, and the two above would be the residential component as well. The downtown plan, the proposed downtown plan, redevelopment plan, did not provide a redevelopment opportunity on this property. What that plan did was basically hold the status quo for Miller's, World of Variety, and Ace as well. We did have some plans on the east side of South Main Street that were identified for redevelopment in that quadrant in the southeast corner of the area there. That project included a potential three-story mixed-use building at the corner of East Verona Avenue and South Main Street. I will say the redevelopment of these parcels is consistent with that downtown plan, due to the fact that the redevelopment was planned basically along this entire corridor, so it is consistent with the intent of the plan itself. As the Plan Commission is aware, the city does have a residential phasing policy that restricts or limits the number of multifamily units to 25 to 50 new multifamily units each year. There are exemptions to that policy, which includes downtown redevelopment and also mixed-use projects. This project does have the potential to be exempted from that policy. A couple of staff comments. I think in general, staff is supportive of the redevelopment of these properties. I think it's an interesting opportunity that's being presented to the city with the fact that World of Variety is currently vacant, and also the fact that Ace would become the tenant in the building here at West Verona Avenue and Schumann Street. So you wouldn't be losing any additional tenants out there. You'd be maintaining a nice business that we have in the community. I think of great importance of both these buildings as creating a high quality project that has an exceptional level of architectural design, and just making sure that it fits with the overall downtown, because this project will act as an anchor for future downtown redevelopment. This has a potential to kind of kick off potential other projects in the downtown area as well. So making sure we have a strong presence and a strong design features in this project is going to be critical. But staff is supportive of redeveloping these properties. I know the applicants are here tonight. The owners are here tonight as well. They'd be happy to answer any questions. So with that, staff recommends the Plan Commission review the submitted materials and provide feedback to the applicants.
Thank you, Mr. Serra. Comments, feedback? Mr. Lytle, please.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I'll jump in first. I think Adam captured my perspective pretty consistently in terms of the opportunity this presents in the middle of our downtown. I'm particularly pleased to see that it encourages us keeping a local business in Ace Hardware and gives you all an opportunity to phase it, so at least it minimizes impact on your operations. The primary concern I have is a four-story building in the way it's currently envisioned here would really be a shock to the west side of Main Street. I was going to suggest looking at a three-story building as an alternative. I think I personally wouldn't throw out the idea of having a four-story building if you incorporated some of the different jogs to the building, setting back the fourth floor. I think there would be alternatives I'd consider if that really drives the project economics to have a fourth story on that building. I kind of think whatever gets approved, there are going to be people saying it looks horrible, and there are people saying that's the best thing that ever happened to downtown. So we'll want to be thoughtful about what goes in here. But overall, really, really glad to see this plan come forward.
Thank you, Mr. Lytle. Other comments, questions? Mr. Horsfall, please.
Adam, do you know what the density is of this project? I didn't see it.
So overall, you have 55 units. The site itself is approximately 1.4 acres, which then puts that, I believe, at a density of 39.2 dwelling units per acre.
Okay. I'm also with Patrick that I think four stories here is, I'm one of the people that would not like that. So I mean, Park Bank's tall as it is, kind of lines that corner. So I'm more in favor of a three-story building more than a four-story. So that's my comment.
Thank you, Mr. Horsfall. Other comments? Mr. Linder, please.
Thank you, Mayor. Yeah, three stories, I think, is on that road would be better. The moving it away from the road would be make it a little better. I don't know how feasible that really is for either side. I do like the rendering that's currently on the screen. Maybe break it up a little bit more if possible, but in general, I think it looks relatively good. It doesn't look as dominating as the Schumann or as the Main Street side. The parking, probably want to get one stall per unit underground. That's kind of been our standard for a while, is one of the questions I asked earlier. And then the density of about 40 is pretty high. I mean, but if you get rid of the fourth floor, maybe that brings it down. I'm not sure how much they'll bring it down, but that would be one of my concerns. Is the biggest concerns I have are the density and how close it is to the road and the height of that building on Main Street.
Other comments? Mr. Heinzen, please.
Sure, thank you, Mr. Mayor. And a question for Adam. I'm looking at, in the packet, the last two pictures. One is of the four-story building, and the next one is of the three-story building, but it looks like the additional piece was then built onto the back. Am I correct in that?
So the second to last page in the packet, that's the one on South Main Street, is that
right?
And then the last page is the full, the one on the screen before you even as well, is the full phase of the project. Okay. It's the complete build out.
And is the is the three-story included, because the developers just have not decided what they would prefer?
No, the three-story, so the three-story one is the one at Schumann and West Rhone Avenue. So there's two buildings to this. You have this building at Schumann and West Rhone Avenue, which that's where Ace would be located. So it's on the screen here. Second building would be along South Main. So there's two separate buildings in this submittal.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. Linder, please.
Thank you. I did forget something. I mean, I just want to say I'm in the idea of actually redeveloping and putting the mixed use there, I think, is potentially a nice spot to do that. But, you know, there are some hurdles to overcome. But in general, I like the idea of redeveloping the area.
Other comments? Mr. Manley, please.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I also am supportive of the idea of doing a redevelopment here and having a mixed use component to it. I guess where I struggle a little bit is looking at the density of this project is very similar to the density of the project we reviewed a few minutes ago. And when you add them together, you're almost at 340 additional units that we would be approving, which is an awful lot. And I know that we have the capacity to exempt mixed use from our multifamily phasing plan, but at some point I think we have to ask ourselves as a city, how much is too much all at once? And I guess I kind of am of the opinion that bringing, you know, 340 apartments online, plus the Steve Brown apartments, is an awful lot for the city to try and absorb, especially in one area. So I think it's something we should be mindful of with respect to this project. Now, maybe some of that is mitigated by changing the height of the building on Main Street. You're probably gonna end up with, I'm guessing you'd end up with fewer units. So I guess that's something that at least I would factor into the calculus on this project going forward. The other thing I would just say is that although I think that the architectural drawings that were included with the project look nice, I would like to see just a little bit more of a breaking up of the roof line and not having just a complete, you know, sort of straight, very boxy looking building for both of them. Both the building that would be situated on Main Street and the one that would be on Schumann Street. So that's just a little bit of feedback I would give to the applicant. I would like to see it move forward. I do think it's a good project.
Thank you, Mr. Manley. Other comments? Otherwise, my thoughts are pretty much along the same lines as others that we've heard. I am supportive of this project moving forward. I do want to make sure that we don't box ourselves in too tight, that we have enough setback. And I want to make sure that in that alleyway that there's enough, that there's access to the property to the south. That's important to make sure that we continue to have that. Overall, I am supportive of the project. And I guess my other comment on multifamily is I think the downtown area is a good place to have multi-development if we're going to do it. So I can support multifamily even at a higher density in that area. Any other comments on this? Seeing none, we look forward to this coming back to us. And it will be on the agenda for Common Council on Monday as well. With that, we are on agenda item number 11, which is reports and comments from the Planning Department. Mr. Sayre, please.
I have nothing tonight.
Reports and comments from the Planning Commissioners. Go ahead, Mr. Horsfall.
Do you know when the hotel is going to be completed? Liberty?
No, not off the top of my head. I think.
Okay.
Spring, I think it was last I heard. Spring, summer. I don't know off the top of my
17?
Head.
17?
Yes.
Any additional comments?
Wisconsin.
Mr. Lytle, please.
Adam, you mentioned the one daycare we'd seen back behind Pizza Ranch appears to be a no-go. The property that was formerly the Velocity development, can you share the latest on that, at least as far as you know?
Yep, they're still working on their plans, is my understanding. I know I spoke with the architect for the project a few weeks ago, and they were working with some banks on financing for the project. So my understanding is it's still a go, but they're working through the finances of it.
Mr. Manley, please.
Thank you. Do we know what stage the Steve Brown project is in? I know that we talked about that project tonight in the phasing, and I'm just wondering how close they are to moving forward.
Yeah, Mr. Sarah?
They're going to pull permits in the coming weeks here, and that's going to get started as soon as they can. And they have no problem with the phasing plan that was outlined from the Plan Commission. So, I mean, it hasn't been an issue at all. But they're going to pull permits on all the buildings at once. So every building they'll drop a permit on, and that gives them the flexibility. Then as they take the first one out of the ground, they can shift around the commercial ones if they want to. But their intention is to transition the whole site and complete it, I think, by, end of 18, early 19. So that's still the plan. Nothing has changed on their end.
Seeing no other comments, a motion to adjourn would be in order.
So moved.
We have a motion by Mr. Heinzen. Is there a second? Second by Mr. Manley. All those in favor of adjournment signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, no. Motion carried, and we are adjourned. Thank you.